Hi all, today we'll be discussing about grounding and shielding related to electronic and electrical equipments. So you might have already heard about grounding and shielding, right? Grounding is a very familiar term, grounding or earthing. So what is grounding basically? In case of electrical engineering, you can say that ground or earth is a common reference point or from where voltages are measured, or it provides a direct return path for electric current in a circuit. Right. So electrical circuits may be connected to earth or ground for several reasons. One is exposed metal parts of electrical equipment are connected to ground so that failures of internal insulation will trigger protective mechanisms such as fuses, etc. in the circuit in order to remove power from the device. This ensures that exposed parts can never have a dangerous voltage with respect to ground, which could cause an electric shock if a grounded person touched them. Right. Connection to ground also limits the buildup of static electricity when we are handling electrostatically sensitive devices. For measurement purposes, earth or ground serves as a constant potential reference against which other potentials or voltages can be measured. In electronic circuit theory, a ground is usually idealized as an infinite source or a sink for charge, which can absorb an unlimited amount of current without changing its potential. We generally use the term ground very commonly whenever we speak with electronic circuits. Now, what is the importance of grounding and shielding? That's what we are going to discuss today. Inadequate shielding and bad grounding are often blamed when measurements are inaccurate, especially in high impedance applications. So whenever we are doing some regular experimentations and measurements, many times, so often, the errors which we get in measurements are due to inadequate shielding and bad grounding. So this happens because there are a lot of stray electromagnetic fields, stray energies, stray voltages that are appearing in your measurement environment that affects your actual measurement which we are doing in the lab. So this is why these external signals or voltages should be shielded properly from the measuring equipment in order to get a proper measurement of whatever we are measuring, right? So, in fact, shielding and grounding problems are frequently responsible for measurement errors, but many test system developers aren't sure why these errors are actually occurring. Many measurement errors can be traced back to currents from external fields that have become coupled into the measurement test leads. So, this is what we talked about recently. Currents and magnetic fields, which we get from external fields, right, stray fields, stray electric and magnetic fields actually affects the measurement of the actual stuff that we have to actually measure in the lab. There are different reasons for which we earth or ground a system. Three main are safety, system protection, and performance. So one is safety. It protects the personnel working in the lab, working with the measurement equipment or working in the lab against electric shocks, etc. Second one is system protection. It protects the measuring equipment against any circuit failure. Third one is performance. It helps us in measuring the accurate value of the parameters which we are going to measure, and insulates our measuring equipment or measured signal from any other stray electric or magnetic fields. Sometimes wrong grounding configurations oriented to satisfy special power and performance requirements of electronic loading equipment can compromise safety rules, generating dangerous situations for the personnel as well as equipment within the measurement environment. So, in general, the safety of personnel in the lab, equipment safety, and the performance have to be analyzed together. In any case, safety rules within the lab or measuring environment should not be violated. It is grounding. So proper grounding techniques are necessary for safety, equipment operation, and performance, as we already said. what we do is, in general, metal parts of equipment enclosures, racks, raceways and equipment grounding conductors susceptible of being energized by electric currents must be effectively grounded for the above mentioned reasons. Grounding these metallic objects actually facilitates the operation of overcurrent protective devices whenever ground faults occur, and thus permits return current from the electromagnetic interference filters and surge protective devices connecting line to ground or line to chassis to flow in proper fashion. All mechanical equipment in the electronic equipment area should be carefully bonded for an electronical safety and for noise current control. Such equipment should be grounded or bonded to local building steel using direct or high frequency grounding and bonding means. So these are certain theory about why we should be using grounding and shielding facilities. But we'll directly go into grounding systems that we practically use in our lab or other electronics equipments. Grounding for fault and personal protection. First one is system grounding or earthing. This is the most common grounding or earthing system that we use. In this system, it involves ground connection of power services and separately derived systems. They include generators, transformers, UPS, etc. It is actually the intentional connection of a circuit conductor. Typically, we use the neutral on a three-phase system to earth. Right, the neutral wire on a three-phase system is connected to earth. So this is actually called system grounding or earthing. Why is it being done? The purpose of the system grounding is for electrical safety of personnel and equipment as well as fire safety reasons. Grounding of power systems is from a safety standpoint oriented to limit the potential difference between grounded objects in order to provide good operation of overcurrent protective devices in case of a ground fault. Now there are two basic requirements for grounding power services. The first requirement is to bond the neutral or secondary grounded circuit conductor to the equipment grounding terminal or bus. So that means the neutral part of the conductor is connected to the grounding terminal or bus, equipment's grounding terminal or bus. For power services entrances, the incoming neutral conductor is connected to equipment grounds in the switchboard by means of a main bonding jumper. For separately derived sources, neutral must be bonded to the equipment grounding terminal or bus. Now the second requirement is that equipment grounding terminal or bus must be connected to the nearest effective grounded electrode by means of grounding electrode conductor. So there are two basic requirements in any grounding power services. First requirement is bond the neutral or secondary grounded circuit conductor to the equipment grounding terminal or bus. Now second requirement is equipment grounding terminal or bus must be connected to the grounded electrode by means of grounding electrode conductor. So there is an example circuit which shows grounding connection for an isolation transformer. Now there are different types of grounding. The first one is system grounding or earthing. There are different types of grounding like equipment grounding, standard grounding, etc. We'll go into the details of these different types of grounding in the next lectures. Thank you.